Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Welcome to worship this morning. I am sorry that we cannot be together, but my son Caleb woke up this morning with a high fever and all the typical symptoms of COVID, and after running a rapid test, we learned that he is positive. And so, of course, we're concerned about him and our family, but we're also concerned about you and your safety. I've been fully vaccinated for some time, but we know breakthrough cases do happen. So I wanted to stay away from all of you until I can get a negative test myself later this week. So out of an abundance of caution, we are live streaming the service this morning with you all safely at a distance. We are the church together and we are the church apart, and I hope that at least some of us can be together again soon. I ask for prayers for my own children, but also for the four other young children in our congregation who have been sick with COVID this week, as well as one of our staff members who has a son who's been very sick, and another staff member whose grandson has had a fever with COVID for 9 days now. Please continue to do whatever it is you can do to help protect the children of our community. They have no defenses at this point, except for us. I invite Susan now to lead us in our call to worship.
Please join in the call to worship as found in your order of worship. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, O my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praises to my God all my life long. Do not put your trust in princes, in mortals, in whom there is no help.
When their breath departs, on that very day, their plans perish. Happy are those whose help is in the Lord our God. So this is a little strange way to do a children's chat, kiddos. I'm trusting that you have your own thumbs ready for your responses. I hope that you all have had a really good week, and I hope that you have a really good week this coming week, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Now, I want you to think about a time when you have gone to the doctor, not for a checkup, I know we all do that, but some time when you've been sick. And I want you to think of the things that a doctor does to help you when you're sick. So whisper to your grown-up, well, you don't have to whisper because you're not in church, but you can speak to your grown-up and tell them some of the things the doctor does when you are sick to try to help. I'm going to share some ideas I had with you. Thumbs up if you've ever had them take your temperature. Or have you ever had to have a blood draw where they put a needle in your arm or in your finger to get some blood out? Have they ever looked inside your nose or in your ears or in your throat? Has a doctor ever given you a shot to make you feel better or a prescription to pick up from the pharmacy? Has a doctor ever had you go potty in a cup to see how you're feeling and to look at your level, your numbers, and have to ask a doctor about what that tells them? But those are all things that the doctor does to help you feel better. They get information and then they tell you what to do to help you feel better. Well, in a little bit, Miss Susan is going to read us a story. Actually, she's going to read us two stories from the Gospel of Mark. And I'm going to preach on the first one. But I want to also tell you this second story because it's pretty wild. And it's about a healing that Jesus does and not in any way that any of our doctors would do today. So some people brought a man to Jesus, and this man was deaf. Can you touch the part of your body that's affected if you're deaf? He couldn't hear, right? And in addition to not being able to hear, he also had a speech impediment, and that meant that he spoke in a way that was kind of hard for people to understand him. Sometimes people who are deaf have trouble learning how to speak clearly because we learn how to speak by listening to the people around us speak. So this man had kind of two problems. So anyway, these friends bring him to Jesus. And Jesus doesn't take his temperature, and he doesn't look in his ears, and he doesn't give him a shot. Instead, Jesus puts his fingers in the man's ears, then he spits, and then he touches the man's tongue. That's pretty wild. And then Jesus looks up to heaven, and he gives a big sigh. And then he says, "Be opened." And the Bible tells us immediately the man's ears were open and he was able to speak plainly. Now that was a miracle. That is super cool. And that meant so much to that man and to his family. But also this miracle is a really important clue. Because earlier in the Bible, the prophet Isaiah told the people that they needed to pay attention because one of the ways that they would know that the Messiah had come was that the blind would receive their sight back and the deaf would be able to hear. And so in this miracle where Jesus heals this man, we're given a clue about who Jesus is. Now we know who Jesus is and we know that he is the Messiah. And we give thanks for all the many things that Jesus did in the Bible and continues to do in our lives today. Let's have a quick prayer. Dear God, we thank you for this healing story in the Bible. We thank you also that you have equipped doctors and nurses and scientists and all kinds of smart people to be able to bring healing to us when our bodies are sick. And we know that you are called the great physician, so that when we're sick, we can call on you too. So we pray for the people in our community who are sick. And we thank you for the healing that you bring about for those who call on you. I pray for the children, wherever they are today, that you would watch over them and care for them and help them as they continue to grow in their understanding of who you are and who you're calling them to be. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Today's scripture reading is from Mark chapter 7, verses 24 through 37, and contains two stories of healing by Jesus. From there, he set out and went away to the region of Tyre. He entered a house and did not want anyone to know he was there. Yet he could not escape notice. But a woman whose little daughter had an unclean spirit immediately heard about him, and she came and bowed down at his feet. Now the woman was a Gentile of Syrophoenician origin. She begged him to cast the demon out of her daughter. He said to her, "Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs." But she answered him, "Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the children's crumbs." Then he said to her, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." So she went home, found the child lying on the bed, and the demon gone. Then he returned from the region of Tyre and went by way of Sidon towards the Sea of Galilee in the region of the Decapolis. They brought to him a deaf man who had an impediment in his speech, and they begged him to lay his hand on him. He took him aside in private away from the crowd and put his fingers into his ears, and he spat and touched his tongue. Then, looking up to heaven, he sighed and said to him, "Ephphatha," that is, "be opened." And immediately his ears were opened, his tongue was released, and he spoke plainly. Then Jesus ordered them to tell no one, but the more he ordered them, the more zealously they proclaimed it. They were astounded beyond measure, saying, "He has done everything well. He even makes the deaf to hear and the mute to speak." Please join me as we offer thanks to God for these holy words.
In Genesis 18, Abraham argues with God, begging God to consider the innocents before he annihilates Sodom and Gomorrah for their wickedness. "Suppose there are 50 righteous within the city. Will you then sweep away the place and not forgive it for the 50 righteous who are in it?" God capitulates. "If I find at Sodom 50 righteous in the city, I will forgive the whole place for their sake." Abraham decides to press his luck. "What about 45? What about 40? 30? What about 20? Abraham talks God all the way down to 10. If there are 10 righteous people, God will not destroy the city. Spoiler alert, the city was decimated by sulfur and fire from heaven, and Lot and his family were the only ones who were spared, so there must not have been 10. On a mountaintop in the book of Exodus, Moses intercedes with God for the people on the ground who are worshiping a golden calf. God wants to destroy them. Now, Moses was also appalled and angered at the people, so much so that when he descends the mountain, he smashes the tablets bearing the 10 commandments written by God's very hand. But up on that mountain, he goes toe to toe with God, arguing that God needs to consider the divine reputation that is on the line here. Why should the Egyptians say it was with evil intent that he brought them out of Egypt to kill them in the mountains? Moses urges God to remember the covenants with Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. God's mind changes, and the people are spared. In the book of Job, we see Job, his wife, and his friends all struggle with concepts of justice, God's righteousness, and the relationship between sin and suffering. And after lots of theologically problematic yammering, God finally speaks, putting Job firmly in his place. Who is this that darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Where were you when I laid the foundation of the earth? Is it by your wisdom that the hawk soars and spreads its wings toward the south? Job responds by literally putting his hand over his own mouth. Our modern prayers to God are often exceedingly polite. But there is plenty of precedent in the Bible for getting down in the dirt and wrestling with God. Sometimes, like in Abraham's case, God works with him toward a compromise. Sometimes, like Moses, God changes course. And sometimes, God lays the verbal smackdown, as Job experienced. But regardless of God's response, struggling with God is part of the life of faith as depicted by Israel's heroes. We can think also of the emotional pleas of the psalmist, or of Jacob, who literally wrestled with God and had his name changed to Israel, because you have struggled with God and have overcome. Now, our story for this morning fast forwards to the New Testament and features a rhetorical contest or struggle between Jesus and a desperate Gentile Syrophoenician mother. Jesus has retreated to the Gentile region of Tyre, where he is hiding out in a house, hoping that no one will find him. Now, you will remember that in Mark, there is the messianic secret. People aren't supposed to tell what they know about Jesus. He heals and teaches and swears people to secrecy. But we know humans well enough to know that we're not very good at keeping secrets, especially when it comes to something as exciting as a healer. Despite his efforts at censorship, this woman immediately, there's another one of those great Mark words, immediately heard about him and came and bowed at Jesus' feet. She begs him to cast the demon out of her daughter. Jesus' response is unexpected. And if we weren't talking about our Lord and Savior, we'd probably describe it as cruel and xenophobic, if not racist. Let the children be fed first, for it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. Though it would not have been unusual for a Jewish man to think and speak this way about a Gentile woman in this context, I still wonder how those words landed for her, especially when they were spoken by someone that she thought might be able to help her. Now, in his troubling response, Jesus employs a metaphor of bread. The Greek word translated as food here can mean either bread or food of any kind. I'm going to go with bread. It is not fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs. Now, we careful readers recall that it was only about 40 short verses ago that the disciples were collecting 12 baskets full of extra bread after Jesus fed 5,000 men with 5 loaves and 2 fish. We celebrated that story as a symbol of the ethic of abundance in God's kingdom. But now, Jesus expresses concern that to tend to this woman's urgent need, she is desperate enough to approach a male Jewish stranger to ask for help. To meet her urgent need would somehow detract from his mission. It would be diverting resources from those he came to feed first. Jesus is concerned about Israel, God's children. But this woman is worried about her child. And she is certain that there can be enough mercy for everyone in need. Sir, even the dogs under the table eat the child's crumbs. This outsider, this Gentile Syrophoenician woman, steps boldly and unapologetically into the great tradition established by Abraham, Jacob, Moses, the psalmist, and Job of making demands on God's mercy. And she does so brilliantly. No matter how she might feel about being called a dog, she accepts his premise and works from within the framework to subvert the system and get what she needs. She concedes the dehumanizing slur that she and her daughter are dogs to make her broader point. Nothing given to them will take away from the children. The dogs are able to graze under the table all the while the children eat their fill. What's dropped to the floor is excess. It's already been discarded. That's all she's asking for. Just some scraps. Let the children eat. Just please also throw a dog a bone. This encounter with the Syrophoenician woman is even more disconcerting when we back up to the passage immediately preceding this one. In it, Jesus chides the Pharisees, quoting the book of Isaiah, "This people honors me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me." He criticizes the Pharisees for being hyper-concerned about traditions around hand-washing and other things. He tells them that they have it backwards. There is nothing outside a person that going in can defile, but rather the things that come out are what defile. It is our sin that comes out of us that defiles. And Jesus lists a whole long list of defiling things that arise out of the human heart. Also, in this conversation with the Pharisees, Mark tells us that Jesus declares all foods clean. So it is startling that after erasing the boundary between clean and unclean foods, after pushing back against traditions that do not bring people closer to God, he turns right around and here in Tyre with this desperate woman writes off people as unclean or unworthy. He turns right around and upholds traditions that harbor disdain for Gentiles. Let's think back for a moment on our passage from last week when we talked about being not only hearers but also doers of the word. In this interaction with the Syrophoenician woman, we see Jesus pushed to go beyond simply declaring things clean to also be a doer of his own words. This woman challenges him to follow up his words with deeds that match. On the heels of the declaration that no food is unclean, this woman boldly argues, if the mission comes first to the Jews, but eventually extends to the Gentiles too, then go ahead and let the Gentiles start nibbling on the scraps now. After all, her daughter cannot wait. Jesus finds her argument persuasive. And like Abraham and Moses, who actually move the needle on what God had in mind to do, the woman persuades Jesus to shift course a bit. He says, "For saying that, you may go. The demon has left your daughter." Her mission is accomplished. Her daughter is healed, and from a distance even. Now, this healing is a preview of what comes later for the church. Jesus pulls the curtain back just a shade for us to see that his ministry inaugurates the time when the Gentiles will be invited in to be part of God's people. Later in the book of Acts, Paul and Peter, both in separate encounters, will come to the understanding that yes, God has thrown open wide the doors to the Gentiles. And in fact, that is where Paul's mission will focus throughout his ministry. Now, we can read this story as one of great triumph for this woman, as a story of great triumph for people who might otherwise be excluded. Use your voice and stand up for yourselves. Claim your spot at or under the table. Hold leaders' feet to the fire so that they live up to what they say, so that they be doers of the words they speak. Be so bold as to even hold God's feet to the fire in the spirit of the great heroes of our faith. And that's an important message for those on the margins, for those who struggle to be heard, who struggle to have their needs met. But for those of us who are used to navigating the world with ease, for those of us for whom the systems work so seamlessly that we are at risk for never even noticing a woman like this with an ill daughter hidden at home, this story has perhaps another message as well. For the affluent and powerful, this woman offers us a needed model of humility. She understands that she is a guest in Jesus' presence. She understands that hers is not the only need, and that, in fact, there are those who maybe need to be prioritized over her. And she is content to take only what she must have to survive. She is content with the crumbs that she can scavenge from the floor. This woman is a reminder to us, Gentiles who have come to know God through Jesus, that we are recipients of incredible grace. We were once far off, but through Jesus have been brought near enough to nibble on the crumbs. We were not the ones with whom the great covenants of the Old Testament were made, but through Jesus we have been invited in to join God's people. The grace of God is that we are not treated as if we are any less just because we were late to the party. Even so, we respond with humility, recognizing that God's mission was always to the Jews first. But thanks be to God with an eye toward our eventual inclusion. Through Jesus, like this Gentile, Syrophoenician, desperate woman, there are scraps to sustain us too. Thanks be to God. Amen. As we turn our attention now to prayer, I'd like to direct you to the prayer concerns that you would have found in the weekend email that went out yesterday morning. And I have a few updates for you. As I mentioned before, we have several families in our church who currently have COVID in their homes, including some families with small children. Pastor Deborah has requested prayer for her grandson, Archer Thomas, who has been very sick for over a week. And also Nancy Myers, who is one of our custodians, has asked for prayers for her son, Jimmy Myers Jr. He has been in the emergency room this week with COVID as well. There is a request for prayer for Joe and Shirley Kirby due to health concerns. We also pray for Charlie Bundrant, who is a friend of the royalties due to health concerns. We pray for Jim Goble, who's recovering from shoulder surgery that he had this past week and seems to be doing well. We also continue to pray for Carl Schofield, who has moved to rehab and hopes to go home late this coming week, so pray for him. The Rising family has asked prayer for their extended family, asking for peace amidst uncertain circumstances. And also, we want to pray for Ethan Goodman, who this weekend had an accident on one of the electric scooters and had to have surgery on his arm, but is now home and recovering. He is the grandson of Ann Goodman. She asks for prayer. I am sure that you have brought with you other prayer requests, and I invite you to bring them before God now as we pray. And I have a prayer here today for Bread from the World. This is a prayer for Labor Day that will guide our time this morning. Let us pray. Almighty God, Creator of the world, we give you thanks for the gift of stewardship and work. Deliver us in our various occupations from the service of self alone, that we may do our work in truth and beauty and for the common good. God of justice, we pray for all workers, that they would receive fair compensation and treatment in their labor. For those who seek work, provide jobs, both citizen and immigrant alike. For those who cannot work, provide sustenance. Make those who lead the industries and commerce of this country responsive to your perfect will. Build up in the leaders of our country a respect for all labors. Deliver us, Lord Jesus, from the maligning evils of greed, sloth, and gluttony, that we may lead lives of holiness in service to you and our neighbor. We ask all these things for our good and your glory. And now from all around this city, we unite our hearts and our voices to pray the prayer that Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The text we looked at today I find troubling and intriguing, but one of the reasons that I love the Syrophoenician woman is because she's so scrappy. She is willing to go to Jesus with what she needs. And she recognizes that all she really needs is a crumb, a scrap. And it makes me think of when we gather for communion and we pick up what might be described as only a crumb, just a scrap of bread, and we say that that's enough to sustain us. As you face whatever you have to face this week, may the scraps of God be enough for you. And if somehow they are not enough, may you know that our God is one who is willing to hear your best argument. And every so often, changes course. May God sustain you in whatever you face until we can be together again. In the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, be at peace. Amen.